Ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum. Okay, it's very nice to be here today. It's a privilege for me. I grew up in the city of Islamabad, and I was here until 1997. Then I moved to London to live, to make a living, and to destroy things. Because I was a destroyer since my young age. This may come as a shock to you all, but the reason why I want to tell you about my own life is because I was once studying in a school just like this one. Has anyone been to G104?
Yes.
You know the moral college there, Islamabad moral college for boys? That's where I studied. And my principal used to say that even shaitan seeks refuge with Adnan, or from Adnan. So this is how devilish I was at that time. Because I always had an urge to do something in life. I didn't believe in passive life or living without any purpose. We all have a purpose. And the lecture I will be delivering today is on that very purpose. You are a legacy. Your life, your presence in this school, and what you will attain at the end of your studies is a legacy which you carry. Whether you realize it or not, that's another question altogether. But you people are special people. You people are a very powerful people. You people carry a lot of potential in your bodies. I'm okay with that. My voice, Allah has blessed me with a loud voice. Turn it off, inshallah. I always had ambitions, even when I was young. I used to have hobbies. I was just like you guys, the way you are. I used to listen to music. I used to listen to Awadis, you name it, I had it. And I had aspirations. I wanted to do something in my life. And then that caused me to learn, to read. I studied history. I visited some of the historical sites in this country, some of the Mughal remains. Has anyone been to a place called Rohtas?
Yes.
Wow, mashallah, I'm impressed. Okay. So you've seen the fortress there?
Yes.
Big, gigantic, massive fortress.
Yes.
That fortress on its own had a massive impact on my mind. That reminded me of our past as Muslims, or as human beings. Because every Muslim is a good human being, right? So we inherited a legacy which we must adopt, understand, and revise, and revive for the future generations. We inherited a very powerful legacy, which I will come to address in due course, inshallah ta'ala. But before I do that, let me tell you something about my life. So I was a child growing up in Pakistan, went to school, lived a couple of years of my life in a village in Haripur. You know where Haripur is?
Yes.
The dangerous place. And then I lived in a village there. I've lived a village life. I used to help my grandfather in the fields. And then I used to help him to take care of the buffaloes he had. So I lived that life. Then I moved to Islamabad, went to school, caused catastrophes and disasters in the school. The principal wasn't happy with me. Wasn't into studies very much. Then I went to college, then moved on to London, where I lost my mind for 3 years. Because I went to London, my father wasn't there to watch me or watch my back, and he was the only man I feared on the face of this earth. There was no one else I feared more than my father, for obvious reasons. And He wasn't around to watch over me, so I went crazy. I did this, I did that, I don't want to go into too many details in case you get shocked. Okay? To put it in a nutshell, I had some of the top DJs. You know what DJs?
Yes.
All of you know DJs, yes. I knew some of the top DJs in London. Those who used to play in clubs, big, massive, gigantic clubs. And there was a time in my life when I used to visit these clubs, and I was such a fearful character, a fierce character, that the bouncers, you know the bouncers? Who are the bouncers? Sorry? The security. And you know the security in London is not like the security here. When you see a skinny man standing on the gates and how are you doing? No. They are big, massive guys, very often black Jamaican guys, with big muscles. So when they used to see me coming with my entourage, they used to open the doors. Free of charge, go in, no problem, no trouble. This is how my situation was in London, there was a time. But I was sick of my life was empty of any purpose. I used to listen to music, I used to organize gigs and this and that, and I was thinking this is what life is, but that wasn't the life I was looking for. Or that wasn't the life I was supposed to be living in the first place. Because I wasn't made for that. I wasn't happy. Then I was brought back to Pakistan because my grandfather, he had a stroke. And I loved him very much. And he was dying on his deathbed. Are you paying attention?
Yes.
He was dying on his deathbed. And I saw him dying because I was so close to him. I loved him so much. I couldn't take that experience. I said to my father, how can he save this man? My father said, even if you feed him gold, he cannot be saved. He's dying. We won't save him. That's when the reality of this life struck me. I saw my grandfather. He was a very strong man. Even when he was 70, in his 70s, he used to carry, you know, bori bags. He used to carry those bags, big full of corn and other stuff. And I couldn't carry it. He was a very strong guy, so I fought him collapse. And then that was a wake-up call for me. I realized that we will one day die like this. He's dying. I will also die. So what now? What do we do now with life? How do we live it? Do we carry on living the way we are living and eventually die without having done anything in life? Or should we live as we were asked by Allah to live? The first question is, who are we? That's the first question I asked. Identity crisis. I had an identity crisis. I didn't know who I am, what I stand for, or what I was made for. Okay? So I'll ask some of you guys as to who you are. Can you explain to me who you are, brother? Stand up. What's your name?
My name is Tarek Musa.
MashaAllah. Who are you? Okay. Okay. What's your identity? What do you see yourself as? Primarily, what are you? Who are you? It's a difficult question, right? Can anyone? Thank you, Sean. Anyone else? Brother, you. Yes, please stand up. Don't worry. Who are you? You don't know. How old are you?
17.
So you never thought, you know, I got married when I was 17? It's not difficult. I'm not going to encourage that in case your school, the American kicks me out. I'm not going to encourage that. I was 17 when I got married. When I was 18, the whole city of Islamabad knew me for some strange reason. Because of the training my father gave me. Okay? So you're a man. Do you see yourself as a boy or a man? Boy? So when are you going to become a man then? It's time to become a man. Yeah, go ahead. Sorry? ID card doesn't determine anything. ID card just tells you that this is what your name is, that's what your date of birth is, and that's who you are. That's the village you come from. That's it. It doesn't tell you who you are. Who are you? Have you ever thought about this? Anyone else? Can anyone else help me? Sister, can you tell me?
What do you think?
Hijab. Yes. Who are you? Please, stand up. Sorry? That's your name, right? But who are you as a person?
Muslim.
Muslim. You are a Muslim as a person. Right, that's the best answer. Well, this is what you are. Primarily, you guys are Muslims. Have you ever thought about this? Have you even sat down for a second in your life and thought as to who you are? Have you ever thought? Have you seriously sat down and thought, who am I? Why was I made? What am I doing in this world? Did you choose to come here? You didn't choose to come here, right? Did anyone choose to come here? No. Now you're here. All of you. Now you are on this planet. Unfortunately. This is the life you're facing. A philosopher once said that being born, listen to me carefully, being born is like being hijacked, being kidnapped, and sold into slavery. You understand what that means? You didn't choose your eye color. You didn't choose your complexion. You didn't choose the way you look. You didn't choose your height. You didn't choose your parents. You didn't choose the village you were born in or the city or the house you were born in. So you're a slave. Someone, somewhere, decided that you must be born into a family somewhere in Pakistan, and here you are. You didn't choose to be here. So you are just like slaves. Whether you like it or not, this is the reality. You didn't choose none of this. And you will not choose when you die or where you die. If you had the choice to choose whether you should live or die, how many of you would choose to die? You want to die? Come here, I'll make it easy for you. You would choose to die?
Yeah.
Dangerous man. Keep an eye on him, guys. One of the things which man fears is death. For obvious reasons, because we are not sure as to what will happen after death. It is our faith, it is our deen Islam which actually encourages us to be patient and to be confident and to be content with this life and be content with the destiny of Allah who created us. So you were all born against your wishes, okay? And you were made to put here by someone, and there is a purpose for your life. So this is something you need to think about, something very profound. You didn't choose to be here. Now you're here. Why? What is the purpose? What are you supposed to be doing? So Allah tells us in the Quran, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنْسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. We created man and jinn not except for worship. So the Prophet of Islam, Prophet Muhammad, was told that, say, O Muhammad, my life, my death, my sacrifice, my prayer, everything is for God, everything is for Allah. So the Prophet was told effectively that everything you do in your life is for God. Everything. When you smile at your parents, you don't smile at them because you want the money in the pocket. Sometimes you want, you know, you want 100 rupees or 50 rupees, I don't know how things are now in Pakistan. How much do you get for pocket money? Sorry? 100 rupees. Yeah? What's the average amount you get? Sorry?
1 lakh.
Sorry? How much? Give me a figure. 5,000? Who said 5,000? Give me your father's phone number, man. He used to donate some money to us. Come on. So when you want money from your parents, you smile at them. You don't smile for that. You smile at them because you love them because Allah told you to love them. You smile at your neighbors, you support them, you help them, or you smile at the poor. You feel sorry for the poor, you want to help the poor because Allah told you to do so. You remove something harmful from the road because that is an act of worship. So effectively, even when you go to the toilet, even when you go to the toilet, did you know this? Did you know this? That when you go to the toilet and clean yourself properly, it's a form of worship in Islam. You're being rewarded for that. You're being rewarded for that. So all of these things, your life, your death, your sacrifice, your praise, everything's for God. So you are effectively a slave to Allah. Whether you like it or not, every single thing in this universe, the moon, the sun, the stars, and the planet Earth, the winds, and the ozone layer, and all the radiation, and all the light and the heat, everything necessary for your existence, the right amount of oxygen and carbon dioxide, and all of these things, were put there by God Almighty for your existence. For you to be nurtured. And here you are. Here you are. That's the purpose of your existence. So that you recognize Him and worship Him. This is a reality you cannot deny. You know you're real, right? You all exist.
Yes?
Yes.
Yes.
You all exist.
Yes.
You all exist, mashallah. Yes. So you all exist, then the one who created you, the one who is responsible for your presence, also exists. Right?
Yes, sir.
And He is more powerful than you are. Right?
Yes, sir.
Right?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
So He's more powerful than you are. So who are you to challenge Him?
No one.
So when you listen to music, when you want to take the phone number of your sister to chat her up, I know what you guys are. I was there once. I know exactly how you think. If you don't fear Allah, then you are nothing but a bunch of devils. This is what you have to understand. The woman, because you are men, right? How old are you?
16.
Sorry?
16.
How old are you?
16.
You? 17. Are you a boy or a man? Tell me honestly what you think. You think you're a man?
Who said it before?
Okay. So you think you are a man? Do you think you're a man? You think you're a man? Yes? Why? You see the age we are living in and the sisters here. What do you think you are? A woman or a girl? How old are you? 16. So do you think you're a girl or a woman? You think you're a girl? Wrong thinking. Wrong thinking. Let me tell you something. You are all a bunch of men and women. Realistically, in reality. Maybe you don't realize it. Maybe you don't realize it. You are already accountable in front of Allah. If you do wrong things now, you will be held accountable. You have gone beyond the age of puberty. Unless you're going to shock me. Most of you are already beyond the age of puberty. And you are held accountable for your deeds now. You will pay for your deeds now. You're not children anymore. You know how old Muhammad bin Qasim was? You know who he is? Who was he? Who was Muhammad bin Qasim? Put your hands up. Wait. Don't tell each other. Who was he?
He was a conqueror and he led the Muslim armies.
Okay. He was a conqueror and he led the Muslim army. How old was he?
17.
Come in. You're 17, right? You're 17. He looked like him. He's 17. And if I was to tell you now that he conquered Sindh and he conquered land as far as Multan, would you believe me? Why not? Why not? But listen to me. Guess what? He has the potential to do it. Because it's been done. It's been done. It's not difficult. I'm not asking you to conquer any land. Come here. You're 16, yeah? Baby face. Now, he's 16. He's 16, right? Okay. Do you know Osama bin Zayd? Wait, put your hands up. Don't say yes or no. Don't guess. Do you know Osama bin Zayd? Who is Osama bin Zayd? No, one brother knows. Any one of you? Okay. Okay. So none of you know who Osama bin Zayd is. Stay here, brother. Yeah, don't run. None of you know. Who knows who Tupac is? Put your hands up. Don't be shy. Don't be shy. Don't be shy. Don't be shy. I'm not going to eat you. Let me see your hands. Come on, guys. Don't be shy. Okay, a few. Maybe 50%. Put your hands down. Who knows who Britney Spears is? Justin Bieber. Or Bieber. Put your hands up. Let me see. Okay, put your hands down. Now, this is a dilemma. This is the catastrophe we're facing. The Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They know more about people who don't know even about themselves than the people they were supposed to be knowing. This is the dilemma we're facing. And I don't blame you for this. I blame the social order, the environment we live in, unfortunately. You've been nurtured and groomed in such a way that you can't even think about your past because you have been deliberately deprived of that past. And believe you me, once you get to know about your past, what your ancestors and predecessors achieved, you will be different people. Osama bin Zayd was 16 years old when the Prophet of Islam appointed him as a leader of an army which was going to fight the Romans. You know who the Romans were? Yes. Romans were the most powerful people on the face of the earth. And the Prophet, don't be scared. Fine. Osama bin Zayd was a leader appointed for an army which had people like Umar. You know Umar?
Yes.
Abu Bakr, Ali,
yes.
Uthman,
yes.
Alhamdulillah, you know these names. That's a good thing. All of these people who were grown men, Abu Bakr was 60 at the time. Listen to me carefully. He was 60 years old at the time when Osama was appointed as a leader of the army. Now imagine if President Zardari was to be removed. Inshallah. And what's your name? Shahzaid. And Shahzaid was to be appointed as the president. Would you panic? Okay. I will take another 5 minutes to tell you about the legacy. The point I'm making, Shahzaid, the point is that you all have a lot of potential. A lot of potential. You guys can achieve what you cannot imagine to achieve. Don't waste your lives. Don't waste your lives. Because you people, you are the people who are going to carry this nation through all the problems it's facing. You are the people who are the future of this nation. You are the people who will go out and make sure that the people who are living in the villages of Pakistan are rescued from the poverty, from the disease, and from all of those problems. Some of you may be doctors, some of you may be engineers, or pilots, or generals, or something like that, whatever you become in life. But have a purpose. Have a purpose. Think of achieving something before you die, because you will all die one day. Because you're young people now, maybe you don't think much about that. But you are all facing death. We are all facing death. That's the reality. You know when the floods came in Pakistan, or the earthquakes, you know how many young people died? They were in a school in Muzaffarabad. Very recently. They were in a school and they died. So death doesn't actually warn you when it comes. We should all aspire to do something in our life, like our ancestors did. Let me give you a few examples very quickly about the legacy of our predecessors, our ancestors, why they were so great, why they achieved so much in the past. You know the University of Oxford?
Yes.
You know about it? Who wants to study there? Who wants to study there? Put your hands up, don't be shy. Don't be shy. You don't want to study in Oxford? It's one of the top universities in the world. Cambridge? Okay, good, good. Guys, Oxford University, which is one of the top universities on the face of the earth, you know how it was established? You know how it was actually made, the university itself? I'm studying right now in the University of London, at Birkbeck College. As I speak, I'm trying to finish my master's. Inshallah, I'm going to go into a PhD. Pray for me that I pass my PhD. Okay? The point is that this university, the University of Oxford, was established by some Muslims in Spain. How? Not physically. They didn't go to England to establish the university physically. What they did was, they reached such a high level of learning in Spain that the whole world was looking up to them. You know, today when we talk about education and technological advancement and sophistication, who do we look up to? The West. For obvious reasons. We're going to give them that credit. They are very powerful people. They have a lot of knowledge. The British Library has 170 million documents in their possession. Do you know what that means? That's immense knowledge. Okay? These people are very powerful because of the knowledge they have. Harvard, Oxford, Cambridge, Columbia, all of these universities are top universities in the world. This is what the situation of Spain was in the Middle Ages. In the 10th century, Cordoba, you know, the city of Spain, Cordoba, Cartaba, it's known as Cartaba in Arabic. In English or Latin, it's Cordoba. I've been there myself. And that was the largest city on the face of the earth. Largest city on the face of the earth. The Europeans, the Westerners, English, German and Frenchmen were learning Arabic. They were learning Arabic in order to get education from the Arabs in Spain. They came to Toledo, they came to Cordoba, they studied with the Arabs, they collected all of this knowledge and they took it back to England, to be more precise. This happened in the 12th century, 1100s. You know 1100s? About 9 centuries ago. That's when this happened. And there was a man called Daniel of Morley. Okay? To give you a specific example. This man, he collected a lot of books from Spain, came back to England, and got together with a man called Bishop John of Norwich. Both of them, they established schools of philosophy in Oxford, in a place called Oxford. And these schools later on came to be known as the University of Oxford. The Muslims were directly behind this, the Arabs in Spain. Arabs, when I say Arabs, Muslims, Jews and Christians collectively, as a human family. You see, this society consisted of people from different walks of life, from different religions, from different backgrounds, and they came together and they reached such level of civilization that they were able to change people in other lands. This is why Daniel of Morley, he came to Spain and took his knowledge, took it back to England and established that university. Also, very quickly, I have to finish very soon. Also, people like Adelard of Bath, Robert of Ketton, and Michael the Scot. All of these people are Britishers. And there's a book I recommend, strongly recommend, and this book will shock you. This book will shock you. The book is titled The Matter of Arabing in Medieval England. This book actually talks about all of this legacy. So there was a man called R.W. Gunther. He wrote a history of the University of Oxford. In this book he states that the first science which was ever taught in this university was the science of astronomy. You know what that is? Anyone? Put your hands up. Sorry? The science of astronomy. The science about the heavens. When you study the movement of stars and the position, where the sun is, where the moon is. This was the first science ever taught in the University of Oxford. And the books came directly from Spain. From Spain, in Arabic. The books are in Arabic. What about poetry? Poetry. You know about poetry? You know Shakespeare? Yes? You know about Shakespeare, right? Put your hands up. Good. You all know Shakespeare. And have you read some of his works? You have. Yes? Good. Shakespeare was directly inspired by a man called Chaucer. You know Chaucer?
Yeah.
Canterbury Tales? Okay. Chaucer, his name was Geoffrey Chaucer. Chaucer was a poet alive in the 14th century, 1300s, in England. And he himself was inspired by a poetic tradition known as troubadour tradition. Troubadour poets, listen to me carefully, maybe this may be very technical for you, but I'm giving you some examples as to how this knowledge from Spain encouraged the literary tradition in Europe. Troubadours were wandering poets. You know what that is? They would go in lands and they would look at the nature and then they would form poetry about it, poetical verses. And this poetry was in rhyme. It would end in rhyme. Just like, you know, Urdu poetry is of Iqbal? You know Iqbal's poetry is? Just like that. It would end in rhyme. And the first people to have come up with that tradition, whereby the poetry would end with a rhyme, were the Arabs and the Chinese by the 7th century. And in Spain, there was a poetical tradition known in Arabic as tarab, to sing poetry in a rhyme. And from this word, tarab, came the word troubadour. You see the similarity? Tarab and troubadour. Troubadour poets then inspired the rest of the Europeans to form their poetry. So poetry as it comes today originates with people like Chaucer, who was directly inspired by this troubadour tradition. And then Chaucer inspired people like Shakespeare, and Shakespeare is the father of English poetry. Coming to philosophy very quickly, I have to summarize.
And
sorry?
Shakespeare is better known as a dramatist than
But he was a poet.
Yeah, he was a poet.
Yes.
He's really poet. It's debatable whether he's a father.
Sure, sure. I know him as a poet. I hardly read his dramas or his. And he was a great poet. So poetical tradition came in that way. Then we come to philosophy and history of philosophy. Do you know John Locke, anyone? No? No? You don't know John Locke? Okay, let me tell you about someone. Oh, wrong note. Okay, before I go on to John Locke, this is a £20 note. Queen Elizabeth, okay? And on the back you find a man called Adam Smith, on the back of £20 note, who was born in the year 1723, died in 1790. Does anyone know Adam Smith? Wow, I'm ready. Yes, please tell me who he was. Sorry? He was an economist. Wow, I'm really impressed. Because at this stage, people are not expected to know people like Adam Smith. Adam Smith was an economist. Modern economic principles in the West, or capitalism, is mostly based upon the theories of Adam Smith. Okay? He wrote a book titled Wealth of Nations. In this book, he proposed, he forwarded his theory, and then subsequently the Europeans, they adopted his theories, and he is revered. He's revered and followed and pursued as the founding father of modern economic principles. He himself was directly inspired by the Islamic tradition. He said that, and I quote, in one of the essays he wrote on the history of astronomy, he wrote an essay on the history of astronomy. He stated, Adam Smith, which not many people know about this, by the way, he stated that the first time after the Romans, after the fall of Romans, who were excellent civilizers of mankind, the Islamic system will enable mankind to have peace, to such a degree which enabled them to create a scientific revolution which in fact inspired the European Renaissance. You know European Renaissance? You know about it? Michelangelo? Da Vinci? Galileo, all these people, all of the scientific works these people are studying has something to do with Spain and Sicily. Okay? So the connection between Islam or the Arabs and the West was very strong, very, very deep. So Western civilization as it stands today, in many ways, originated in Spain with the Muslims. You know the concept of tolerance, concept of scientific advancement, that we must do something in life and help mankind to overcome its problems. A lot of this came from Spain. So this was the legacy of Islam which...
Sure. When we're talking about our identity, firstly, I disagree with the way that you define us all as Muslims first and as anything else afterwards.
Sure.
I think that a huge part of who we are is based on where we're born.
Right.
As in, we have links to the earth that we're born on before we ever gain consciousness of who we are as religious people.
Right.
Why are we forgetting our roots in the subcontinent? And when we talk about doing things for people and human rights, the first person to ever document the first treaties on human rights was from this subcontinent. He was Ashoka the Great. Why are we forgetting those things? Why are we not tracing our identity back to these people as well as just to the Muslims? The Muslims are recent. The history of this subcontinent goes back thousands of years before Muslims ever arrived.
Sure.
Or were thought of. So why are we narrowing things down so much? I always with a Muslim perspective, because I have nothing against religion, but I believe religion is something open to very, very personal interpretation.
Sure.
My view of religion, my interpretation may not be the same as yours.
Sure.
And I always choose not to discuss religion in a public forum.
Right.
Because everybody has somebody else's view of what makes a good Muslim or how we need to interpret
I agree with you, partly some of the statements you made, I agree with you, that Muslims are not the first person to come up with these theories. I agree 100%. The Muslims are not special in that regard, that they're the only people who know civilization or humanity. No, far from it. I wouldn't make such a naive claim, because if you look at the Egyptians and the pyramids and the Greeks and the Romans, they left the civilization behind. What I'm trying to say is, however, that the Muslims, and I will give you evidence in due course very quickly, the Muslims are the first people who brought people from different walks of life and different religions in one place and enabled them to live in peace together. Let me give you an example.
So there was a huge university at Taxila set up by the Buddhists, which brought people from all over the world to come study, not very far from this country.
Well, can you point this evidence to me somewhere where I can go and study some written documents on this?
Basically, the ruins of that monastery and that university are still there.
I've been to the ruins. I've studied them thoroughly. If you talk about the evidence, there is no evidence.
Yes, but that all was you so can much see before written documentation. Let's not forget that history goes back before the history of writing.
Right. Good. What the sister is talking about may be true. I haven't found evidence for it. Written evidence. The point I'm making is that the reason why Muslims are picked on in this particular lecture is because they made a special history. Let me tell you why. Do you know Karen Armstrong? Anyone? Do you know Karen Armstrong?
Yes.
Okay. Karen Armstrong is of the view, okay, and she is one of the biggest academics when it comes to comparative religion and history of civilization. She stated in her book, The History of Jerusalem, on page number 225 or 214. She states that Muslims are the first people. This is what she said. It's not me, she's not a Muslim. That's what she said. Muslims are the first people who enabled three Abrahamic faiths, the Jews, the Christians, and the Muslims, all three of them, to live in peace for the first time in history of mankind. When Muslims were governing Jerusalem.
When was this exactly?
This was she, Karen Armstrong is talking, because the book is on the history of Jerusalem in particular, so she's talking about Jerusalem in general, that Muslims, whenever they had the land, for whatever period, this is the behavior they had. And her testimony is based upon very powerful evidence. Let me give you an example. The patriarch of the city of Jerusalem, you know who a patriarch is? The Christian head, the priest, the bishop of the city of Jerusalem, his name was Theodosius. And he wrote a letter to his brother in Constantinople, who was his contemporary, obviously, in the year 869 CE. This is the 9th century. This is the evidence which Karen Armstrong studied, and she reached the conclusion she reached. Patriarch Theodosius wrote this letter, and in this letter, he told his brother that the Muslims, the Saracens, the term they used for the Muslims was the Saracens, the Muslims do not hinder us in religious affairs, they do not put any pressure on us, and they allow us to live in peace. Number one, okay? Number two, another French traveler, his name was Bernard the Wise. French traveler, he traveled to Jerusalem. We have to finish? Okay, I have to finish. Brothers and sisters, thank you so much. Do I have any time? Want to see some of this evidence I'm talking about, go, I did a lecture in the University of Bristol in Bristol in the UK, and the lecture is titled Coexistence Under Islam or Convivencia Under Islam. Put my name down, Adnan Rashid, in YouTube, and you will see all my debates and lectures there, and a lot of this evidence will come up. Yes, do you allow me to take some questions? Is that okay?
We can have a couple of minutes, but not much longer.
Okay. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Go ahead.
In the earlier part of the lecture, you said that everything we do is according to God's will.
Yes.
So whatever you do has already been pre-planned. So basically, you're trying to say that we have no free will. Then what is the point of all the potential and whatever we do, period? There's nothing after that. Because everything we do has been pre-planned.
All the bad is
we don't have a free will. So we're actually all slaves. So then how can we get out of this?
Good point. There are things which are predestined, and there are things which are destined to happen. I'll give you an example. Things, your life, your death, what you will earn are predestined. These are written. Okay? What you do in your life, you have freedom, freedom in that. So you may choose to do something good or bad. That's why you will be rewarded. God is just. So the book of Quran or the Islamic tradition is based upon one pillar, and that pillar is justice. One may be a good person, and if he's not just, then he has no chance. So justice requires that you are given a fair chance in this life to go and face the trial in the hereafter, right? This is why you have the free will, the free choice, and for that you will be either rewarded or punished, okay? So where you die, how you die, and what you earn is predestined, but the rest you have a choice to do. You know you're striving, and the better job you will get, and I hope you get a better job. And you have a good job, and if you want to strive, if you want to get a better job, if you get it, that was written. That was written. But when you, let me finish quickly, please. When you do something good or bad in life, that wasn't predestined. That was your own choice. So there is a balance between predestiny and destination, okay? So there are things you choose to do in life, which is why justice. This is justice. If you were
being done through smuggling, is that predestined too? Because that's
learning. No.
They have a choice to do that.
No, but the whole point is that I have a choice to stop wearing and not earning. Is God right? Frankly, I do not believe that these things are predestined. I believe that we are born free to choose.
I'm more than happy to talk to you. Continue talking to me after the lecture. That's a very good point. I'm more than happy. What's your name, my sister?
Fizza.
I am more than happy to stay here for another 5 hours.
No, that's not the point. The point is that when it comes to something that we need to debate on, suddenly time is over. The point is that if we're all born and everything is already predestined, then there isn't much point in being here, is there?
No, there is a point in being here. Why? Because being here, are you here now?
I suppose I am.
You are. Did someone put you here?
Look, that's not the point.
No, no, that is the point.
No, it isn't. No.
You didn't choose to be here. You were put here by someone. Someone.
Agreed.
That's it.
Okay.
That's the point.
Yes.
Now that someone who chose to put you here exists. And he's more powerful than
you.
Okay. That's good. So he's more powerful than you and I.
I didn't deny that either.
Good.
That's not the point.
He's more wise than you and I.
Agreed.
His laws are to be obeyed because he's wiser than us.
Yes, but that's
there you go.
That's the point
of it.
Choice to obey or not to obey, because if he did not give me that choice, then the laws are pointless.
That's the point of obeying.
Well,
you have the choice.
Yes.
You have the choice.
That's precisely what I'm saying. That we have a choice. What you're saying is that it's possessive business. Thank you so much for your time and coming here.
I really appreciate it. Thank you so much.
Need to now line up and go back to classes directly. All of you have done that.
Thank you very much for listening.